Have you heard of Artemis One, the mission aiming to bring the next generation of astronauts to the moon? Well, I'm sure that like many others, you've wondered why there was a need to start from scratch, disregarding what was done during the Apollo era. The quick answer is that we need to bridge two different technologies, the analog of Apollo and the digital age we're living in now. The thing is, almost all the information we had half a century ago has been lost. The people who knew the computer codes, the passwords, those who made the designs, the mathematical calculations, most of them passed away a long time ago. Unfortunately, no knowledge can last forever, regardless of the passing of time. Each space mission is unique, carried out by technicians and scientists who tackle problems with solutions that are now indecipherable. Sad, but true. For instance, today we couldn't just clone the missions accomplished by the two Voyager probes. We would have to redesign them from scratch, obviously improving them. This has been a significant obstacle to the desire to once again explore the outer solar system, a desire that over the last few years has been growing stronger because in the meantime, we started discovering exoplanets, many of which have turned out to be quite similar to the gas giants in our solar system. Studying them up close, therefore, might be necessary to understand how these planets form and evolve, which are probably the most numerous in our galaxy. In particular, Neptune could provide us with some really interesting information, especially because it could give us a chance to visit one of the largest moons in the solar system, namely Triton. A peculiar moon, a name that conjures visions of icy and dark landscapes on the edges of the solar system, an alien world, as alien as it gets. Getting there, however, won't be easy, especially if we decide to set up an orbital mission, and not just a flyby like the Voyager probes did. How, when, and how long will it take us to get there? What do you say? Shall we venture to find some answers in this amazing video made for you by the Insane Curiosity Channel? Years ago, the Voyager 2 spacecraft glided silently over Neptune's royal blue clouds at the very edge of our solar system, unveiling a world of wild weather, a powerhouse of energy, and a place distinctly different from its near twin Uranus. The tiny probe's observations of Neptune raised more questions than answers, as did its close encounter with one of the solar system's oddest moons, Triton. After soaring over Neptune's north pole, Voyager 2 dove southward, slicing through the giant planet's ring plain towards Triton, which had loomed ever larger over the previous 15 months. By August 25, 1989, the moon filled more than half of the spacecraft's narrow-angle lens. Yet despite its apparent size, Triton was much smaller than expected, just 2,700 kilometers across, roughly three-quarters the size of our moon, but still among the solar system's largest natural satellites. Pre-Voyager mass estimates, based on how much sunlight Triton reflected, turned out to be off the mark. Back then, it was speculated that Triton's diameter might even exceed 5,000 kilometers, vying with Ganymede and Titan for the title of largest moon in the solar system. Traveling at 63,730 kilometers per hour, Voyager 2 came within 39,800 kilometers of Triton's center, revealing a world of profound complexity and providing a dramatic finale to a 12-year, four-planet grand tour. Later, the discovery of Eris and the media frenzy surrounding Pluto's demotion overshadowed this distant and mysterious satellite. Yet its peculiarities are truly extraordinary, both dynamically and physically. At first glance, Triton seems to have all the credentials to be considered a natural giant of Neptune's satellite system. It always shows the same face to the gas giant, just like our moon does to Earth, and the Galilean moons due to Jupiter, and its orbit is almost perfectly circular, two features that usually indicate a satellite formed alongside its planet. So it would seem impossible to view Triton as an intruder. However, there's a certain oddity in its orbit that once spotted makes it clear that Triton could not have originated there among Neptune's other moons. This anomaly, especially considering the object's significant size, can only provoke disbelief. What are we talking about? Well, the fact that Triton's orbit is retrograde. In practice, Triton is like a big truck driving the wrong way on the highway. A truly bizarre occurrence, because all the larger objects having formed from a single rotating disk of dust orbit the Sun counterclockwise. Mind you, there are other moons in the solar system that orbit their planets retrograde, but these are tiny moons, essentially small asteroids captured by planets in various ways, and all are located on the outskirts of the satellite system that welcome them. Triton, however, is very close to Neptune, just 350,000 kilometers away, less than the distance between the Moon and Earth. Moons in retrograde orbits can't form in the same region of the solar nebula as their planets, so Triton must have been captured from elsewhere. It likely originated in the Kuiper Belt, the icy object ring just inside Neptune's orbit. This belt is thought to be the source of most short-period comets we see from Earth and houses several large planet-like bodies, including Pluto, now recognized, along Eris, as the largest of the Kuiper Belt objects. Triton is just a bit larger than Pluto and nearly identical in composition, suggesting a shared origin. The prevailing theory is that before its capture, Triton had a mass companion like Pluto's moon, Charon, forming a binary system. Orbiting the Kuiper Belt on a highly eccentric path, they stayed too close to Neptune. Triton then transferred all its orbital energy to its companion, flinging it away, while Triton was snagged into a retrograde orbit. This event likely wreaked havoc on Neptune's moon system. The sizes of Neptune's other 13 moons, quite small, hint at a catastrophic past event. Unlike the other gas giants, Neptune lacks mid-sized moons, 500 to 1500 kilometers in diameter. Some astronomers believe Neptune once had such moons, but Triton's arrival scattered, destroyed, or ejected them from the system. Before going on, be sure to leave a like and subscribe to our channel by clicking the bell. This will encourage us to do better and you'll never miss any of our weekly videos. Titan's retrograde orbit makes it a dark, almost magical world, like something out of a fantasy novel. But what about its surface? Triton holds another record. It's the coldest body we've studied in the solar system, with surface temperatures around minus 238 degrees Celsius, even colder than Pluto. Its low temperature and significant mass allow it to hold a thin atmosphere, 99% molecular nitrogen, with traces of methane and carbon monoxide. The surface pressure is less than 1/70,000th of Earth's. At such temperatures and distances from the Sun, you'd expect an icy, crater-marked ball, a monotonous landscape frozen in time. But no, Triton's surface is constantly renewing. Voyager 2's sharpest images covered only a third of Triton's surface, revealing a curious, ubiquitous, greenish cantaloupe terrain, named for its resemblance to the melon's ridged skin. This terrain features roughly circular, interlocking depressions, each about 25 kilometers wide, crisscrossed by long, interconnected ridges, likely from epochs of melting and resurfacing. Speculation abounds that the heat-melting Triton's surface likely stems from the intense heat of its capture by Neptune and the orbit's subsequent circularization. These immense tidal forces may have caused significant crustal fractures and surface melting, leaving large smooth regions or basins and craters filled with lava-like flows, probably water ice. The largest visible crater, Mazamba, is only 27 kilometers in diameter, suggesting the surface's relative youth. During its flyby, Voyager 2 captured images of at least four active geysers, marked by vertical plumes of black smoke rising up to 8 kilometers before bending parallel to the surface, driven by prevailing winds over 100 kilometers away. This phenomenon might explain the dark streaks formed by deposits of fine dust seen in Voyager's photos. For many planetary scientists, the geysers suggest that Triton might harbor a vast ocean of liquid water beneath its icy crust, heated by tidal friction. However, tidal friction isn't the only heat source inside a terrestrial body. There's also radiogenic heating. This heat produced by the decay of radioactive isotopes within a moon or planet can generate warmth for billions of years. But does heat plus water equal life? Well, the chances of life developing in Triton's ocean depths are much slimmer compared to Europa, but it can't be completely ruled out. Ammonia, likely present in Triton's seawater, could play a crucial role in lowering the freezing point of water, making it more conducive to life. Needless to say, these are just suppositions, likely to remain so until we reach the moon's surface with an automated mission. There's a good reason why, in the entire history of space exploration, only one mission has visited Neptune and its moons. The journey is incredibly long and difficult. The planet is 4.5 billion kilometers away, 30 times the distance between Earth and the Sun. But this might be one of the lesser problems. To understand the difficulty common to many other outer solar system objects, let's step back to the days when Voyager flew over Neptune's North Pole after a 7 billion kilometer journey. Yes, you read that right. Although Neptune is 4.5 billion kilometers from the Sun, Voyager 2 had traveled almost twice that. This is because space travel is rarely a straight line, and the probe needed continuous gravitational assists to increase its speed and adjust its trajectory. By saying assists, it had to steal kinetic energy from massive planets it could approach by deviating from its path, planets like Jupiter, Saturn, and Uranus. Indeed, while increasing speed, the journey's length also grew to the necessary detours. But was it worth it? The calculations are complex, but we can assure you that without those gravitational assists, Voyager 2 would have taken about 18 years to reach Neptune. Instead, it only took 12, saving time, fuel, and resources. This proves that gravitational assistance is a highly advantageous technique for space missions, despite its drawbacks. Not to mention that without the directional changes imposed by the two flybys with the gas giants, the probe would have never been able to sequentially visit all four gas giants of the solar system. Now, one might object, okay, Voyager 2 took 12 years to reach Neptune, but why did the New Horizons probe only take 9 years to reach Pluto, which at that particular time was only slightly further away? The difference between the two missions depended on several factors, including speed, trajectory, and maneuvers performed by the probes. The New Horizons was launched in 2006 with an initial speed of about 58,000 kilometers per hour, the highest ever achieved by a probe headed outward from the solar system. Moreover, it took advantage of a gravitational assist with Jupiter, which allowed it to increase its speed by about 14,000 kilometers per hour and save time and fuel on a path that allowed it to reach Pluto in 2015 after a flyby of about 5 billion kilometers. Voyager 2, on the other hand, was launched in 1977 with an initial speed of about 35,000 kilometers per hour, lower than that of New Horizons. Furthermore, as we have seen, it followed a more complex trajectory. But it's not just a matter of speed. Another limiting factor for all spacecraft sent to the edges of the solar system is the weakening solar light as one moves further away from our star. At certain distances, solar panels become utterly useless in producing energy, and the mission must necessarily use a nuclear energy source, namely a nuclear battery, which would end up weighing down the spacecraft and reducing its speed. But apart from this, there's another factor complicating the exploration of Neptune and Triton. As we've seen, Triton is unique among the large moons of the solar system because it has a retrograde orbit. This implies that the probe will have to adapt to a relative speed very different from that of Triton. Since the moon moves in the opposite direction to Neptune's rotation, the approach speed will be greater compared to a moon with direct motion. This requires careful planning to perform significant deceleration maneuvers, as well as a greater amount of fuel to carry out the necessary maneuvers. It seems that with current technology and launch power, a serious orbital exploration of Neptune and Triton can't be done in less than a dozen years. Since 2019, there's been talk of a possible mission nicknamed Trident, with three pronged goals: orbiting the magnetic field to determine the presence of an ocean, mapping the entire surface, and using a camera to measure plume activity. In 2021, however, NASA gave priority to missions to Venus, believing that a simple flyby of Triton by the Trident probe would not yield significant scientific results. Currently, the Neptune Odyssey proposal is under consideration, targeting a launch in 2033 using the Space Launch System and a 16-year cruise directly to Neptune, with yearly launch windows during the 2030s. The journey could be shortened to 12 years with a gravity-assisted Jupiter, but this would require a launch before 2032. A 220-kilogram atmospheric probe will be released from the orbiter before orbital insertion in Neptune and will descend for about 37 minutes into Neptune's atmosphere to study its composition, dynamics, and processes. After achieving Neptune orbit, the orbiter will conduct at least 46 flybys of Triton over the 4-year main science phase, achieving near global coverage of the moon while simultaneously studying Neptune and other moons. The orbiter would then progressively orbit closer to Neptune and its rings in a grand finale, similar to Cassini's, and eventually be destroyed in Neptune's atmosphere for planetary protection purposes. What can we say? We just have to wait and hope in the great God protector of space missions. Less war and more interplanetary probes should be everyone's motto. Right, guys?